I'm going to commend Emerega for revolutionizing the water sector. In a sense, talking from a group, the MUS group, the Multiple Use Water Services Group, that's just one of the many networks, that's a network of people from the domestic water sector and from the irrigation sector who realize that domestic systems have been used for productive uses, for especially livestock, small scale enterprise, crafts, etc. And irrigation people have been realizing, oh, our irrigation canals are used for also for cattle, for car washing, bathing, and a lot of other non-irrigation uses. So basically realizing that these rigid, truncated silos in the water sector don't make sense on the ground. We have been looking for an alternative. And at that moment we realized that we had Tushar and Silv's reports and Anisha's work, and we said, wow, that's the main to get beyond the sectors. And of course we know a lot of issues are there, but the promise of an alternative, an holistic and integrated water development and water management approach has three big advantages over the sectoral approaches. In the first place, close together, it's multi-purpose infrastructure. You don't build an irrigation canal only for irrigation, for single use. You know that if you invest in infrastructure, then you try to get as many users as possible for more livelihood benefits, more users and more livelihood benefits. And the argument is then that if you make a pipe anyhow, why don't you make it a little bit bigger? You can get many more users, and the incremental costs are limited. So it's small incremental investments for many incremental livelihood benefits. And of course, for the larger reservoirs, nobody would build one dam for domestic uses and one big dam for irrigation uses. Of course, it's not good. But somehow, that's basic understanding gets lost when it gets to the more local levels. But, Malik also found it, and when you start calculating benefits, it's mostly for local users. And that also means that you don't get damage from the unplanned users, which you see in domestic systems or single-use systems, is that the cattle still gets in and you trample because you haven't made something for the cattle. So that is one set of benefits. Water is integrated. There is a local water cycle that has never been really tapped. But if we get to the ground bottom-up planning, then it automatically becomes the use and the reuse of multiple sources. The rain, the service streams, the ponds, the wetlands, the groundwater, all these conjunctive uses get tapped in an integrated way. And then last but certainly not least, it's finally people-driven, people-centered priorities. And for example, the rehabilitation of existing workers is often more cost-effective. But in the domestic sector, the irrigation sector, you want to build new schemes. In any case, certainly in the domestic sector. The accountability is often from the top, it is bottom-up. And then Enrega has also the component of employment creation, which gets the whole force also on the agenda, and I will come back to that. So this is a type of ultimate integration of water development and management that we wouldn't get out of the sectors, but what Enrega is has been funding, and I will come back to others as well. In another well, you could say it's multiple use services below, and that was what the Pacific Institute did. You can say local planning, you can say Enrega. It is a bottom-up way of integrating all the different approaches in the water sector. And Enrega has then taken up another lovely example, that also the convergence from above. Let's try and make the silos collaborate. This this is now being replicated elsewhere as well, but it hasn't been studied so well, in the sense that the broader participatory projects, that if you really give basically the money straight to the communities, if they can decide about the allocation of the local, of the public resources, and well, water can come up or not, but it comes up, if you give it directly what it comes up in a more accountable way. Very interestingly, the same, we find the same, but we haven't really studied it, in South Africa, where the community work program explicitly says we are an employment safety net, no guarantee at all, a safety net. But the Indian model is very relevant, and of course it has been an inspiration to us. So the, it was great that Shield could come to South Africa to tell about NREGA to the people of the community work program. And again, we are talking now about a pilot phase in South Africa, but already almost 100,000 people reached, and very much an ambition to get every ward of South Africa at least one site in the toekomst. It's very interesting to see how the implementation set up is. Here, the community work program works with implementing agents. It's under the Department of Corporate Governance and Traditional Affairs, local government, but it works with implementing agents and tries to empower local government. This is, has of course a lot of sustainability issues as well. Who will be the owner? Interestingly, in the last 5 years there are more of this type of projects. We did a study for the Onderwerp Foundation in taking two examples, Nepal and Tanzania. And in Nepal, the Poverty Alleviation Funds, which works through partner organizations, because there is no local government in Nepal at the moment, but also strengthening local government planning. Again, it started with the community-driven development initiative in the World Bank in the early 2000s, and it has been piloted, and now it's really taking a lot of momentum. Here, also 500,000 people reached since a couple of years. And donors like it. They like to put a national fund that goes straight to the villages. And again, in this case, we don't know exactly how much of the priorities that people said was about water. But again, we see water services, water resources, etc. Tanzania, a similar approach, but they call it Tanzania Social Action Fund. They work more directly with government because the area has always emphasis on local government. Again, World Bank, International Development Association, the World Food Program, DFID also comes in, and people start getting interested. And here we also start, talk about millions of people that have been reached. Generally, another example in Tanzania is the whole strengthening, the capacity building of local government planning, and then especially from the top to the districts to the sub-districts, but the critical step really getting to the villages. That is usually the step that is weakest. So this opportunities and obstacles to development tool is now, JICA's interestingly quite behind that, is now really workshop throughout Tanzania and more or less adopted for any intervention in two-thirds of the local authorities. And again, we do see that the tool that they use about mapping your own resource, the own resources as a village, what are opportunities, and take it from there, make your rank your needs, prioritize your needs, what to do before, what can we do this year, very important, what can we do next year. This somewhat longer term planning comes out as a major way to get beyond the political type of fighting and always giving the same money to the same people because once of funding same people. It comes again as a one of same people. But if you plan it, you can say, now, this is for you, but next year it's really another village. This type of transparency, well, these are the tricks of getting the local planning processes right. So again, we don't know what was mentioned, but we don't know really whether it has been used. And that then tallies quite nicely with the water sector itself, where we see, but quite fragmentedly, similar initiatives where water is being planned holistically. The first, since the 90s already, Helvetas and Finland are applying this approach in the far and mid-western of Nepal. Where they say it's not open, it's really, we want to focus on water. So there they make water use master plans, longer term plans again, which they then implement, which is domestic use, which is irrigation, etc. But again, now that's it's one funding stream, so the scale is somewhat smaller. In Sarek, they have been experimenting with that, they call it bottom-up integrated water resource management. There was the donor who has been experimenting with that in 8 countries, and now GIZ is taking over that same approach. Another example is Windhoek International. Paid by USAID has always been a promoter of the water-produced water services, and Windhoek is one of their champions to implement that approach with more autonomously, working with the private sector for appropriate technologies as one of the ways to expand the technology choice. Well, there are more of this type of initiatives, and what's interesting is that also that the resource people start realizing we can't just look in this case to 3R, which is the reuse, recharge and retention. The water buffering, how can we buffer water, groundwater basically, at local level. They also realize we can't just look at the resource, we have to look at the management and the needs as well. So they merge the multiple use services approach with the more integrated approach to resource management. It can all, this is general, that can be implemented everywhere, what I mentioned, in the non-irrigated area, in the irrigated areas. The questions then in this, what we could call irrigation plus, in the sense that the priority of the irrigation sector, no, the crop sector, first priority, that professionals remain very strong on that. You get the multi-purpose technology as well. Of course, the multiple sources is, I don't need to tell that here. And then the participatory and the bottom-up, part of that would really be livestock and especially domestic users. What is now really the priority? Can the irrigation people just say, well, we have a water user association, we call it water user, but we basically talk about the landowners with the larger fields who have most power, and we forget about all the other people, the wage workers and all the non-irrigators who don't have any relation to the scheme, we just forget about them in the management structure, or should it be a more democratic, maybe contrived function in which the women and the men will really say what their priority needs are, and then avoid, especially, of course, that the hassle that irrigation water is still being used for domestic users, because there's no. Now this is Pakistan, I think that's in here clearly.
But
we can take those pictures anywhere.
the one which looks more messy. This one is Pakistan.
Yeah, but I think that's
the right.
This is Morocco. Okay. In fact, But I'm going to get a big picture of India, because you can find exactly the same pictures in India, where the cattle and children are drowning, and irrigation water is still used for domestic purposes.
What is the
point of the pollution there? No, huge. No, absolutely. And the whole point is that irrigation engineers, if you ask them, they will say, I can't. I have to forbid that because there are water quality issues, which basically say, sorry, I happen to be in the wrong sector and I don't need to care about what's happening with my canals, because the silos protect the professionals not to have to look to that professionally. So they have to forbid it. But where are the people then going? Yeah, the last question, if we then think about the landless, the women, maybe the sick, etc., the people who wouldn't use water elsewhere, but can only use water around the homestead because it's the only site where they can use water productively. It would be a majority. We would think about the water needs of everybody, and then the question is, wouldn't homestead-based, multiple-use water services not come up as a much stronger priority than now? And especially, is it only the domestic sector who then has to take care of what we could call domestic plus, because the domestic sector is the only one who's really looking at the priority for domestic users, really wants to bring water to homesteads? Or is that something that the water sector as a whole should start realizing, that if we think about the water rights of entitlements or the needs of everybody, not just the people this land for irrigation, but really if we think about the water needs and maybe the human rights to water of everybody, wouldn't this become a much more a stronger priority if it became really a more bottom-up process? So we don't talk about 25 liter per capita per day, but we start talking about 50 or 100 liter per capita per day as a most MDG per drop as basic human rights, and then for the water quality issue, make sure that 5 liter per person per day is clean. But we don't need 100 liter, it just for scrubbing floors, or it doesn't need to be clean. So then, to conclude, what is the revolution in the water sector? That's, I think, Enrega is showing massive skills to the rest of the world. Getting a new type of accountability, not just construction and crops, and yields, etc., but start counting all. Of course, that is important. But start counting all livelihood benefits, and also how they mutually reinforce that. If I have more money, I can pay for my health, etc. If women don't have to work to carry water, they can do other things, girls as well. So get a broader range of livelihood benefits, and especially get accountability around local planning processes. And as the new indicator, how do we manage the issues that you also raised, how do we manage local planning processes in an accountable way? That would become a new challenge for the water sector. In terms of allocation, we don't talk about this water goes to irrigation, this water goes to urban users. We would say this water goes to people, and all people have multiple water needs, especially in the rural area, and especially for women who can't handle this dichotomy between productive and domestic anyhow, because they need both. So we start allocating water to everybody with multiple water needs. And then the big question, of course, how does the truncated water sector at the moment, how do we learn to facilitate the participatory planning and design for and technology choice work with all the technical complexities in a transparent way? In the end, get inspired by communities, because for them, they don't get nervous of multiple users and multiple sources. We have done it since time immemorial. Thank you.
Thank you very much.